Well, if you're looking beyond the idea of scholarships, mentoring programs in our community are big. With us is Chris Kotsakis, the founder and organizer of Artisacon, now in its second year. We're here in Philadelphia at Moore College of Art, where they're hosting Artisacon 2019. Chris Kotsakis, welcome to Cosmos Philly. Give us a little idea about the affair.
Thank you very much. Basically, we are an artist conference. We bring in professional artists that are fine artists, illustrators, sculptors, even writers, editors, and they are seasoned professionals that give their time out of their busy schedules to come in and help mentor younger artists from high school age, college, and even coming out of college. And they have various lectures, panels, demos, demonstrations, live painting demos, sculpture talks on like maybe Hollywood special effects, makeup, action figures. We have comic book artists, fantasy artists, animators. We have a nonprofit here out from Denver called Brinklet. They help youth find their voice with in the writing community, and they're now gone global. They're a nonprofit, so we bring all this talent out to help, you know, network and well, have mentorship for the young people, while at the same time they're networking with one another as professionals, and it has a very nice vibe and camaraderie to the atmosphere, and it's more of a learning experience, not just for the attendee, but I think the guests of honor and the featured artisans get a lot out of it themselves, giving back to the community.
We understand that there's nothing quite like this anywhere in the country going on yet in the arts programs. What was the initial thought? How did this come to fruition?
Well, there's been conventions and comic book conventions, and where you hear comic cons. There's other artist conferences that are genre conferences, whether they focus on a kind of illustration or fantasy art to collectors. But this is really not towards a collector's base or a fan base. This is geared towards mentoring the creators that get into the fields that create these pop culture items or commercial venues. But we also have fine artists that wind up being painters in, you know, gallery scenes, and then they do comic book covers for Dark Horse Comics. So it shows in today's creative market, you can work in various genres, and with global social media, you can work globally. So it has, you know, the opportunities have opened up globally. At the same time, there's a lot more competition because you just see a lot more coming into your, you know, into your vision, into your sight, and your, you know, how do I compete? How do I use Kickstarter as a crowdfunding source to self-publish? That's what we do. We have talks on self-publishing. How do we use Patreon? You know, all these tools to, you know, help the creative individual either be an entrepreneur. We have other artists that may work for Marvel Comics as an anchor, and they just, that's what they want to do. They want to work for Marvel or DC. We have fantasy artists that freelance and they work for Magic the Gathering card. You know, they freelance art, doing art for those kind of companies. So, and we have a lot of young writers. Some are both writers and artists. So the idea is to give them an exposure to these professionals, and they get portfolio reviews, they go through the lectures, panels, demos, and they may pick up, you know, not just, you know, tidbits about these professionals personalized, but what their business acumen is. And we do have a strong business side. We have a couple courses in contracts for creatives and how to start a creative business, and it's my own personal attorney, Seth Polanski's giving talks on that. He's a corporate IP and trademark attorney, tells how the artists to protect themselves, how to set up a business. So even if from a young age, if they're high schoolers or college age and they're coming out of college, these are great ways of implementing this education into their own lives and their careers if they're starting out. And it's a great networking opportunity for existing professionals to make new connections. Maybe an art director sees an illustrator and they may have a job lined up, you know, and go from there. So there's something for everybody here. And why it's really different is we bring artists and writers together. Most conferences kind of separate those two things. It's like a writer's conference or an artist's conference. So we're bringing that together.
So I run a podcast. It's called the Pencil Kings Podcast. And I've interviewed a lot of the guests that are here. And I thought it was an amazing chance to face-to-face meet a lot of the people that I've only heard their voices before. And I know that it's a really intimate, amazing conference. So you don't get access to people like this at a Comic-Con or something like that. So it's a great chance to meet people up close and personal.
Well, tell us a little bit about the podcast. What are they all about?
I interview successful artists and try to distill into an easy to digest step-by-step framework that we can interview for 30 minutes and then break things down in about 5 minutes so that it's the person listening can take something away and implement it into their life right away.
What do you think of the conference so far?
So far it's been great. I enjoyed Carl Potts' interview or presentation this morning, took some more notes and some more pointers that I can take away and bring back to my audience, so I'm excited.
My name is Clark Huggins, and I'm a science fiction and fantasy illustrator. And in the course of my work, I wanted to come up with something that was going to allow me to get to ideas faster, so that I didn't spend my time staring at the ceiling saying, well, what should I draw? And so I created a card deck series called Reckless Deck, and it takes all of the iconic objects and things that you see from all across science fiction and fantasy and horror and comics, and it mashes all those things together. And it mixes them up, and then what you do is you pull yourself three or four cards from the deck, and then it's gonna give you a series of prompts of things that you see in science fiction and fantasy, but that never live together normally. And then you make something out of that. You take those very, very different idea generators and make a new character out of them. And what I found when I did this, which I started just as a sort of exercise or a game, is that the results that I was getting were pretty great. And they were very, very outside of my creative box. And I said to myself, I'd have never done this had I not actually put these cards together. So what it actually does is it really eliminates artist block. Is it smashes through any sort of stuck feeling that you have as a creative, and also gets you thinking way outside of your comfort zone.
Basically, you know, I went to school for art, and I studied illustration, I studied film and animation, I studied sculpture. I worked on the West Coast for a little while in LA doing creature effects and movie sculpture. And then I came back to the East, I live in Connecticut, to be a professor and to write my book, Astromythos, original mythology book, and to do freelance illustration and such.
Tell us about what you do in Connecticut with the museum, and tell us a little bit about your program today, what you were sharing.
Well, in Storrs, Connecticut, right near UConn, there's a new Spartan Museum of American Art, and there's artwork brought in from all over the world, Spartan artwork. Marbles, paintings, all sorts of Spartan-themed works. And I've been serving as the art director there and the curator. And today, at Artisacon, I'm here giving talks. Today I gave a talk on world building, which is a class I teach at University of New Haven, which is where I teach my illustration classes. And I talked all about how to become a storyteller, a writer, an illustrator, and how to combine your talents to publish a story, an animation, or a comic, or a book, an original work.
Artisacon, it's essentially new. It's only its second time. How do you feel about participating, and how significant is this type of program?
It's very significant and important for especially students to come here and to see professionals working in the field and to get inspired by these people and to be informed, as far as where they go and what they have to do after school and post-graduation, how life's going to be, how to face and deal with certain struggles. All this information can be gleaned from these artists, art directors, writers, and it's very important for even budding illustrators and illustrators like me who have been working for about 15 years to talk to these other artists and see what they're doing now and discover new mediums and toss around ideas and things like that. It's very informative for anyone. It's a great convention. I'm glad to be a part of it.
I made the book with a lot of help with other amazing people called Sons of Chaos, which is the story of the Greek Revolution of 1821.
What was the driving factor or inspiration that led you to the book?
Well, it started early on with by a guy named Nick Lambro, and he was insane enough and kept pushing me to like look at this material, and that sort of drew me in. And once I obsessed enough about it and had enough migraines and hydrocodone from the migraines, I inevitably started to see how layered and kind of meaningful the war was, and a war that I had never really known much about, and that nobody seems to know much about if you're not Greek or Turk.
The illustrations, give us an idea of how they came to fruition, how they're being put together for the book.
Sure. Well, it ironically, so I had never done a book like this, and I had written screenplays, and so after getting the screenplay intact and coming upon the reality that this would make a great book, through another long story, came upon an artist in Argentina named Ale Aragon, and he's amazing. He had done other books. He's worked for like all the companies and done a bunch of stuff, and he's amazing. So we started working together, but virtually, and my Spanish was really weak, and his English is a little bit better than my Spanish. So initially we started working from afar, and he tolerated me enough to get it to the point where he understood the story well enough that he didn't need me as much, and what he did was insane. It's amazing. So yeah, it's really Ale that brought all that to life.
When I met Chris Kotsakis a couple years ago, and he told me about this vision that he had about the arts and mentoring, I was intrigued. And when I found out that there was an actual event right in Philadelphia at the Moore College of Art, I wanted to come down and kind of just see how it is. And I'm very impressed with what I see. I think that the arts should be viewed extremely as an important part of not just Greek American culture, but cultures around the world, and especially with Hellenic arts, I see us trying to incorporate more arts programs to the mentorships that we have now. I mean, we have the educational guidance program, amongst other things that we try to do, but to think that arts shouldn't have a place in the world, we'd be fooling ourselves for that. And that's why I think it's important to support this venture, and the fact that he has 500 plus people here is pretty impressive.